need a theoretical physicist, and I'll tell you about quantum computers. Not to worry. I mean, I could give this title for the layman, which is to say, how your gadgets got to be the way they are, and how they'll be completely different in the future. So I'm the kind of person who actually tries to make these gadgets and tries to make them different. But I should say that a physicist usually, for one like me anyway, does not actually consciously say, I'm going to make gadgets, I'm going to make money. It's more that I'm a kind of person who likes to figure out, and the people who made computers and continue to make computers, like to figure out how things work, how to like to explain it to other people, and then try to figure out how they could work completely differently. So I'm going to take you through that process. I'm going to talk about how computers arose and how we might make a big transition into a new kind of computer. I'll begin with some other examples, which are not computers, not really computer technology, but other kinds of industries and technologies. Talk about how innovation is involved in making them what they are, and how it's important in their transformations that we accept new ideas, accept change, and accept the fact that sometimes they have to be ruthlessly changed or done away with in order that new things can come along. So I'm going to begin with one of those examples. It involves an immigrant from here, from Johann. Johann Brill came from Germany to America, to Philadelphia, as a humble workman in the 19th century. And by dint of good luck and hard work and brilliance, he became a great magnate of industry. And in fact, he became, or his company became, the biggest manufacturer of rail cars in the United States, mostly of urban rail cars and street cars. And the reason why this is a special story for me is that this factory, this lithograph you can see of this giant factory complex, was just a few blocks from where I grew up. So I was very connected with this particular factory. And this factory prospered under Herr Brill and after under his son for many decades, but it didn't prosper very long, or it had ceased to be vital around the time that I was born. And I remember being taken as a child to a bridge where you could look over this site, and it was still there, but it was an empty shell. It was a big wreck. So this is sort of not a good example, and in fact, even to this day, some of the empty shells of this 19th century factory are still sitting there a few blocks from where I grew up. So this is not a good example of moving on. I want to give you another example of, again, not computers, but another industry where we've done better, or I think, or you can judge after I've given you the little story. So here's another nice picture of, it's a picture of an impressive big industrial complex. Now, the thing that's interesting about this, perhaps, is that you just walked right past it this afternoon. It is, in fact, the Oranje-Nassau Ain mine, which was right at the train station here where you got off this afternoon. There's still one tiny bit of it, but of course you didn't see it. You mostly didn't see it, and you didn't see any giant wreck either. And in this case, change was accepted. And in fact, in this case, it was the conscious action of the Dutch state that said, this is the wrong way to do it. It's brilliant and it's impressive and it's driven our economy, but we have to change. It's the wrong way to do this work. And in fact, it's a famous event in local history right here in this building on the stage here in the Schouwburg. That the Minister of State came and announced, we are closing the mines. And within 10 years, after 1965, it was done. Now, of course, coal mining has not ended and hasn't even ended here in our Eutropolis. And so if you go off to the edge of our Eutropolis in Hambach, you see the way coal mining is really still done today. And this is, it's radically different from, digging a dark hole and crawling underground and heroically chipping away at rocks. It's done by these giant machines. I have the instinct to use a pointer, which I shouldn't. These giant machines, which are sort of the size of this whole theater building, digging away, these monsters are constantly digging up the electricity we need for, doing our gadgets and so forth. So let's move on to computers. So I want to begin, and I slurred my home city, so I wanted make it up to Philadelphia a little bit by coming back to another point of history. At the time that the Brill factory was about closed, there were some very bright electrical scientists and physicists and engineers at the university in Philadelphia, just a few kilometers from where I grew up. And they invented something new. So they invented a computer. You may know that before, say, the 1940s, a computer meant a person who was good at dashing off figures on pieces of paper. So what they realized was you could do that with electrical devices. And so the Eniac was the first all-electronic automatic computing device. It used as its basic elements vacuum tubes. And if you're as old as me, but maybe not if you're much younger than me, you don't even have this experience of looking in the back of an old television set and seeing these glowing glass balls. And those were racks and racks of these glass balls, these vacuum tubes, were the things that were used to make this computer function. Now, this computer was developed under the pressure of war, and it is said that it was finished just in time to have no role whatsoever in World War II. But it did calculations for the military. It did solve physics problems, artillery shell. It did computations about how those would work, and it did function for a few years. But of course, it was superseded. And then its successor was superseded. And the computer industry is an example of a succession of innovations of physicists, engineers, understanding new ways of doing things, putting them into practice, and wiping out what existed before. So that we've come, by now we've come to, of course, computers are now everywhere. They're small, they're big, they're everything. So I'll choose to illustrate with the big. We still have big room-sized machines. This is one out at the Jülich Forschungszentrum, actually just a few kilometers from where the giant hole in the ground is, the big mine. So this is not mining coal. It's sort of mining knowledge out of what? Well, out of electrons. It still functions according to the same principles as the ENIAC, except way, way, way smaller. That is, all the devices that used to be the size of vacuum tubes are now shrunk down to smaller than the size of a hair. So that, the functioning of the ENIAC is all shrunken down to about a millimeter of this machine. And its overall capability is something mind-boggling. This particular machine is not used, to maintain internet databases. It's used for scientific purposes, for simulating the action of the human brain and for understanding other kinds of physics problems. It seems like physics always is somehow at the cutting edge of how to make, the best and the next machine. So I'm going to move on and tell you now about quantum computers, so my subject, and how it has the possibility of making machines that are as far beyond Eugene, the IBM supercomputer at Jülich, as Eugene was compared with ENIAC. But we're actually taking a new turn that we haven't taken over these 50 years, which is to go back and examine and try to break the rules at the very basic level, at the level that the basic switches of the computer work. So here's a few, technical pictures perhaps about just to say that how do computers work? Well, they work by knowing how to do 1 plus 1 equals 2, and doing it very, very, very much. So it does that with these things which are referred to as logic gates, ands and ors and so forth. And if you ask, well, what's an and or an or, it's some kind of electric circuit. So here's a little sketch of one, and it has some resistors and diodes and things which are called transistors, these Qs. So the reason I reach down to this is that this, say, the transistor, the thing which in some sense has remained functionally invariant from the time of the vacuum tubes to the time of the little tiny things on computer chips, is something we're going to change. We're going to change the basic rules about how they work. So let me talk about for a moment about something about how they work. So what is a transistor? It's something which is a controller. It's a switch. It's something that can turn on and off. What is it turning on and off? Well, for all those years, as all those new generations of computers were discovered, it was involved in the turning on and off of an electric current. So Electric current goes from one place to another, called the source and the drain. And this is a photograph, a microscopic photograph, of how a transistor more or less looks in the present time. It's a very tiny structure etched onto or grown onto a surface of a crystal. And so the current goes through some little obstacle course of barriers and gets to the other side. And the way it works is by the controlling of that current is by what the thing called a gate. So there's a way of turning on and off the flow, of which is accomplished itself by an electric means, by turning on and off an electric voltage. So so that has remained invariant. You know, that is the starting point of building up gates and 1 plus 1 equals 2 and, you know, stock market modeling and, you know, video games and everything is built up on the functioning of these kind of devices. But we're going to change the rules of how they work. But I can describe it in terms of this by saying here's a way of changing the rules. This is always based on the flow of current. So we're going to stop the flow of current. We're going to not have any current ever flowing through this structure. But we'll use something else to contain information, to save information, store information. Because when we bring it to a halt, it becomes more evident that this current is actually composed of individual elementary particles passing, so to speak, one by one through the transistor. So we'll bring them to a halt, and we'll have individual electrons stuck at specific points inside this transistor. Now, an ordinary transistor wouldn't work at all anymore if you did that, but the point is that we're going to use now even different rules for what really processes information, what contains the information that we're going to use to represent data, represent calculations. It turns out that what we will use, or a promising thing to use, is a specific attribute of electrons, the fact that they spin on their axis. So they're charged and they spin on their axis. The spinning produces a magnetic field, so it produces a tiny little magnet associated with each electron, and the magnet being up or down, so to speak, is like the zero and the one of a computer, except the magnetic direction can be anything, so it's a little bit more than just a bit. And it begins to have attributes which we can only describe using the laws of quantum physics rather than classical physics. Now I'm going to say a few words that even I think are going to be challenging for some of the audience, but stay with me a little bit. So we're going to talk about how two of these electrons can be correlated. So suppose you push the green electron and you push it right on top of the red electron. It turns out that the nature of electrons is such that these two spins like to anti-align. They will preferentially anti-align. If one is up, one is down. But up can mean anything. Up can mean any direction in space. But they have the peculiar correlation that if one is up this way, the other one is guaranteed to be down the other direction. And that turns out to be a form of correlation between two elementary objects, between two bits, that is beyond any kind of correlation that we can have in classical systems. And it's the thing which is referred to as quantum entanglement. Now, I'm not going to say that this is easy. In fact, it's exactly the thing that that Albert Einstein, in thinking about, said, this is spooky, this is weird, this is crazy. But in fact, we live with it. I mean, we live with the spookiness, and actually, we don't think of it as spooky at all, in the sense that it obeys clear laws, it behaves in predictable ways, and we even understand that you can, once you've made things that are entangled, you can pull them apart and separate them by long distances, and they can remain entangled. And this sort of pulling apart and then interacting with other electrons is the basis of how you program a quantum computer. Now, as I say, that doesn't really tell you that much about a quantum computer. But I'll try to give you some idea of where we are on this enterprise. So we understand that this is possible. We understand that it will speed up calculations, initially kind of physics and mathematics calculations. But what next? I have no idea whether we'll have the sort of quantum tablet or something. What I can tell you is that there is real current progress in the laboratory in actually making this a reality, but it all looks sort of radically weird and different from any existing computer hardware. So people have been able to put a few qubits onto a chip, and the chip can be mounted into a structure and put into, quote, a computer. Although the main thing that this so-called computer on the right is something that keeps noise and disturbances away from these qubits, because they're extraordinarily delicate, they're extraordinarily sensitive to noise in the environment. So this is really a refrigerator with a lot of shielding. Now, I might say a little bit about what is my role in all this. I'm a theoretical physicist. I like to think about how all this works, and I've tried to indicate what has to be improved in order for this to finally fully work. So this is a very technical little slide, but its message is that we've been able to understand how to measure qubits to tell how well they're working, and over the last 10 years, their basic functioning has improved by about a million. It's actually measured by how sensitive they are or how well protected they are from noise. So improvements of 6 factors of 10 usually make for some differences. And in fact, it has enabled the possibility of assembling large machines and trying to test them out. It's been about 10 years to get to this point, and I predict we're sort of halfway there from the sort of starting point of having hardly anything to where we are now, and then another 10 something like that years we'll really start having functioning devices. So I've also played the role of just saying this is all very sketchy at the moment. These chips only have a few qubits, so I've introduced ideas for, you know, what is in fact the structures that one should grow onto chips to make multiple qubits, a multitude of qubits. So these sort of aesthetically pleasing structures also are sort of engineering diagrams for future machines. I did this for many years as a researcher in the United States, working for IBM Research. But in the last few years, I've come here to this region, and I live right here in Heerlen, and I work at the Aachen University. And in fact, Aachen, which of course began 150 years ago as a place where mine engineers were trained, is now open to having someone like me come and work on the strange subject of quantum information. So in this last picture shows, I try to convey what I really do. What do I really do? Of course, I really answer emails and things like that. But actually, what I really do is in trying to teach new researchers, young researchers, how to do the work I do. I'm having them, you know, in conjunction with me, they try to work things out. Physics also always, of course, gets down to equations. You have to calculate things and model things. And so my role is to have my young workers work things out and to have the taste to perceive that, yes, this stuff on the left, which looks very scribbly and not very nice, is really brilliant, and this is actually not so smart. Thank you very much. Thank you.